You are tuned in to Kids
in the Pit.
Hey guys, it's Gabe from the Kids in the Pit podcast. Today I'm joined by Joey Z from the band Life of Agony. Hey Joey, good to see you.
Good to see you, Gabe. How you doing? I like your apparel, man. The suicidal hat, the Madball shirt. I love your backdrop too. The Kids in the Pit backdrop with the the Mohawk skeleton playing guitar. It's freaking awesome.
I like your backdrop a lot too.
The Halloween theme in the Zampella house.
I like a giant spider a lot. It's really cool.
Giant spider behind us. Yeah, we love Halloween here. It's pretty amazing. Every year, everyone in the house dresses up in, one way or another to go to a party, or my two daughters go trick-or-treating. So, it's pretty awesome. We love Halloween. How about you? You love it?
It's my favorite holiday. If I could, if I had to choose one holiday to keep and the rest are gone, I would choose Halloween. It's the best. It's amazing.
That comes up in our house quite often at dinner around this time of year. We say, okay, what's the best holiday? Let's all talk about it. And it always is a toss-up between Halloween and Christmas, of course.
Makes sense. Because
my daughters, we all love to share gifts and stuff like that. And the Christmas vibe, too.
Yep, Christmas is awesome, too. But
what are you doing for Halloween?
So the song Monosyllabic Girl by NoFX. I'm being a monosyllabic girl, and for those that don't know what monosyllabic means, it means you can only speak in like one syllable words. So, hello.
So give me an example, an example.
Ouch. Stuff like that.
Yes.
Yep.
No.
And if they ask, "What do you want?" I say that and point to it.
That's cool. That is cool.
Yep.
That's awesome, man. You doing anything special? What are you doing?
So we're also trick-or-treating in Daytona with my best friend Lucy, which from Pete from Sick of It All.
Oh, that's going to be freaking awesome.
Yeah, I'm really excited.
That's really cool. To trick-or-treat with Sick of It All, I mean, come on. Especially Pete. I don't think Pete needs to dress up. He automatically can dress up as himself with that mohawk.
Maybe I could, if we did this another year, I could dress up like Pete.
That's what you should do.
It'd be funny.
You know what? Pete should be you, and you should be Pete.
That'd be funny.
That would be fun.
I just don't know. He would just have to buy the clothes that age, like something like, just like, I always wear hats. Steve would have to get a hat, and he would have to,
get a Madball shirt.
Yep. Wait, so he would have to make his mohawk fall down to put on a hat, right?
Yeah, or we just drop a wig on him.
Maybe.
With you, it's easy. You just put on a black tank top, spike up your hair somehow, maybe bleach it white, although your mom might probably want to kill me for suggesting that. That would be pretty funny if you guys dressed up as each other. That'd be pretty hysterical.
I saw that on Pete's birthday, right? Alan dressed up like Pete from Life of Agony. He dressed up like Pete, and he went on stage. It's really funny.
And it happened to be the last show of that tour, that leg, right? If I remember correctly. Oh yeah, that was a fun night. That was really fun. We had a lot of friends come down that night.
Yep.
My friend Mondo, all kinds of family and friends came down that night. So that was a great show. And that venue is always great in Stroudsburg. It's called the Sherman Theater, that place. Always have great shows there.
Sherman Theater.
Yeah. The Sherman Theater in Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania.
We saw show. We saw The Descendants and Circle Jerks and Adolescents there.
Oh, cool. Is that your favorite style of music? Now I'm interviewing you.
Yeah.
But I mean, would you say like punk hardcore is your thing?
Yeah. So I like some just generic hardcore. I like some Metallica. Metallica hardcore. I like some Youth Crew hardcore. Just I like most hardcore. I kind of like thrash metal, but if I could choose mainly just like one, I would choose hardcore, just basic
Yeah.
hardcore.
Now, I didn't know, like, you named a bunch of subgenres of hardcore. I never even heard of those. I must be ignorant or something, but you just
So,
named about four, I think, four subgenres
see,
of
so
hardcore.
generic hardcore would just be like, what would that be? I don't even know.
Like the band Bold or like some old school hardcore bands like
Straight
that.
edge
Like,
hardcore too.
okay.
So, straight
Youth
edge,
of
like
today.
Youth Crew hardcore. That's like Judge Today, Gorilla Biscuits, all them.
You said metallic hardcore, did you say
Yeah,
metallic?
metallic hardcore.
What is
I
that?
mean, would you guys kind of, you guys are kind
Would
of
we
metallic.
fall under that? Is that like Metallica slash hardcore mixed? Like,
Then
is
just
that what that is?
like kind of crossover like metal hardcore.
Yeah, I think that's what we would be. We'd probably drop under that
Yeah, I'd say so.
because I love metal stuff. I love hardcore stuff. Some thrash. But mainly I'm a metal, like right now my favorite band is Gojira. I
Oh,
mean,
nice.
for the last like 6, 7 years I've been listening to those guys hardcore. I really just great band. I just love their music. I love their songs. They're very catchy. They're different than what's out there. That's probably, yeah, I would say Gojira has been my top band for the last like 6, 7 years now. Most
Nice.
listened to band. Without a doubt.
Yep. I'll make sure to give them a listen. I haven't heard them too much.
You should give them a
Listen.
listen. I think you'd
Yep.
like them there because they have aspects of all kinds of genres in their music. Even hard, they have those big drops. Like, you know, like I've seen YouTube videos and their crowd just goes ballistic when they drop, down like like a big drop or a halftime drop. Man, it's hard. They really go hard, Gojira. It's really
Awesome.
good stuff.
Yep.
Really good.
Also, I suggest you listen to the band Counterparts. They're really good.
Oh, okay.
So they
Never
kind
heard of
of
them.
fall under like metalcore, but like kind of like more hardcore than like metal.
Counterparts. That's what
Yeah.
you said, right?
Yep. I mean, actually, they're like, yeah, metalcore. Metalcore is complicated. There's a ton of different bands that are completely different that fall under metalcore.
Oh,
Yeah,
definitely.
Counterparts is really good, and they're one
Awesome.
of my favorite bands right now.
There was a band I just heard. I was driving in my car and I had liquid metal on and I heard this band called Spirit World. I never heard them before,
Yeah, I don't think
just
I've
heard them
heard of
that
them.
day. And the song I heard was called Ulcer. And man, it was so heavy. I was like, but it was different again. Like, there's a lot of heavy bands out there, obviously. But I like when a band sticks out and they're a little different. Like, their riffs don't seem ordinary. Like, they don't seem cliche. Like, a lot of the bands, unfortunately, when I hear them, I'm like, ah, it sounds like, kind of sounds like everything else I've been hearing. But some bands stick out, like Gojira, like Spirit World. There are bands that just I hear and I'm like, okay, now this is something. This is different. There's something about them that makes them stand out above the rest. And those are the bands I usually end up listening to a lot.
Yep. Life of Agony definitely has its like own sound, right?
Thank
Like
you.
there's not really much else that sounds like you guys, I don't
Thank
think.
you. That's a huge compliment. I appreciate that because I feel like that's what we're definitely after this. To have our own thing.
Yep.
Yeah, I appreciate that a lot. That's awesome that you acknowledge that and you hear that in our music. That's really
Yeah.
cool. It was a pleasure having you out there, on the Sick of It All tour.
Yeah,
I
it
was
was really
I
fun.
was yeah, that was a lot of fun and then in what show was that? You jumped up on stage. I watched you and that was
Baltimore.
Indianapolis. Oh, there was another show though. You came out and you sang. You did some vocals, didn't
Oh
you? And
yeah,
what is that? Indianapolis was that?
oh, I thought you meant on the first leg of the tour. Yeah, in
The recent
Indianapolis.
leg, yeah.
Yeah.
That was great. when you came out. I thought you killed it. You were like the, you know, you came out and you slaughtered it. You're like the best one out of all everyone. You and Chris Saletti, you know, our tech came out as well that night because Lou wasn't feeling well. But you did a great job. Thought you were awesome.
Yep. Oh wait, no, that was actually Fort Wayne, not Indianapolis.
Fort Wayne. Yes, you're right. Fort Wayne. I was trying to remember which show it was. Fort Wayne. That's what it was. Pierre's. That was the club. Pierre's.
Yeah. But yeah, weren't you guys originally going to be in a smaller club and like the promoter put you in the bigger room or something?
Yeah. They, you know, sometimes, yeah, it was kind of weird. I mean, sometimes they just feel like, okay, it sold more tickets than we thought it was going to.
Yeah.
Or let's say, I know the band will enjoy this room more, that kind of thing. So it depends on what happened. But either way, it was fun playing the bigger room, of course.
Yeah.
It was a big stage, if you remember that.
It was crazy.
It was crazy big. It was like an arena stage or something in a club.
Yeah, I think like backstage or I don't remember where, but there were a ton of like there were like pictures or something, and there were like some really big artists that I saw that played there or something.
Oh yeah, they definitely that place has been around, and they've had big artists play through there because I mean they have the size, like it definitely has that thing about it that it definitely could accommodate big artists, national acts, and stuff.
Yep. I saw like an old set list. It was like taped on the wall backstage, and it said Kiss.
No, I bet you they did do it.
Which is,
you know,
crazy.
A lot of these big bands sometimes. I mean, I know I do. I like, you know, not that we're huge, but I like enjoying like you know, sometimes a smaller show. So imagine Kiss that plays arenas all the time goes into a place like Pierre's, excuse me, and has just a great time with a packed club. You know, I know Metallica likes to do that as well.
Yep.
You know, occasionally they'll just play like a smaller venue, and it's so intense for the fans seeing one of their favorite bands, or if not their favorite band, playing a smaller room. It's just like magic, you know. Slayer or whoever.
Yep. I saw that Metallica, they were going on, it was a few years ago, but they were going on like a boat show in Miami, I think, on like a giant cruise ship.
Like a yacht? Like one of those metal yacht things?
But then they played a Hard Rock Live, which is like, I think a few thousand people.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, not like 20,000 like they're used to.
Mm-hmm. Or even more. Now they're doing the stadiums, you know. I just had the opportunity to go see them in New Jersey, and it was, I mean, that had to be 60, 70,000 people. It was a stadium, like basically a football stadium, MetLife.
How are the seats?
Well, I went in the snake pit because
Oh, wow.
You know, those guys are really cool. I know those guys a bit for over the years, especially Kirk, who's been a friend of mine.
That's awesome.
He invited me down when I brought my family. I brought my wife and two daughters, and he put us in the snake pit.
That's awesome.
And we were right in the middle there. And
so you got the snake pit for free?
Yeah. No, well, what I like to do is, and I think it's something awesome that Metallica does, is, you know, they send you an email, you know, you got free tickets, and that's awesome and all that, but you can donate to their foundation. All Within My Hands, I believe it's called. That's exactly what I did. Knowing how much those tickets could cost if someone were to buy them, I went home after that and I donated to their foundation. You know, or awesome. Should I say we donated to the foundation, the Metallica Foundation, as a thank you, as a return gift for those awesome tickets. We donated a nice amount of money to that foundation, and those awesome. Guys definitely appreciate that. You know, I think it's so awesome that they do that, and I think it's awesome that their guests go home and donate. Like, hey, we gave you this, then do the right thing, and I think that's great. I think that's great.
What do they donate to?
It's like all Within My Hands. I believe it's a foundation that just is an outreach foundation. I believe you can look it up. It's all over the place, and they do all kinds of outreach stuff, whether it's people who who are not as, you know, just don't have what other people have, people that are in need of help. Those guys are constantly putting themselves out there and helping people. So, I mean, you know, anyone could say what they want about Metallica or this or that, or they, you know, changed over the years and all this crap, their music and whatever. But those guys are the most down-to-earth, friendly, family-like people that I've ever met in the industry. They've treated me like gold, and they've treated Life of Agony like gold. And I'll do nothing but support those guys no matter what.
Yep. So I just saw Suicidal Tendencies, and the bass player is Rob from Metallica's son.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard, I heard a lot about him, and I was just with Rob a couple weeks ago, and we talked about his son a little bit, and his son, I believe he likes, you know, he's a big Life of Agony fan, or he loves Life of Agony.
That's awesome.
I know he follows Mina, I think, on the social media thing, and he was on the side of the stage. We did a festival with Suicidal, I think it was like a year or so ago.
Was it in Philly? Was it Decibel Magazine? A fest in Philly.
It was a European festival.
Oh, awesome.
We were over in Europe. Yeah, and then Mina told me after the show, hey, did you see Rob Trujillo's son watching us from the side of the stage? I was like, no, I didn't even know. And so apparently he watched the whole set, and he was all excited. And so I just think it's super cool. You know, I heard he's awesome. An amazing bass player, too.
He's really good. I saw him, like, he does the, like, finger picking thing, too.
That's crazy. Cool. So cool.
Yep.
His dad is pretty badass, too.
Yep. They were probably the best band I've ever seen. Like, they are so fun live.
Oh, that's awesome. Like, they're all over the place. They go nuts.
Yep. And they're really fun because Mike, like, he's crazy. Like he went on the barrier and started like singing, like right in front of me. And then he like dove on me.
No.
And I got I got hit in the head, but it was worth it. Now now I have bragging rights that Mike from Suicidal Tendencies butt hit my head. Wow. Now I can brag to my friends.
That's so cool. That's awesome. Yeah. Hey, listen, you're here, so it wasn't that bad. You know, you might have like a little bump or a little scar left over, but you could always say, you know, hey, Mike from Suicidal did that to me.
Yep. I lost an earplug though, but.
Oh no. Were your ears ringing for like a day and a half after that?
No, we had a backup earplug.
Good.
But...
Good idea. Definitely a good idea. So how's your guitar playing coming along, Gabe?
Great.
I
just got a new guitar, and I played my first show in New Brunswick, New Jersey, with my dad's band Thought Control.
Awesome. That's funny you say that, because Life of Agony's first show was in New Jersey as well.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's cool. Where was it?
It was in Keensburg. Yeah, I definitely do. It was in Keensburg, New Jersey. It was February 11th, 1990. And the club was called Faces. And we played. That was our first gig ever as Life of Agony. And it was my first Life of Agony gig. So we got something in common. Our first gigs are in Jersey.
Yep. I'll just fill in whenever, like, anyone that could play a string, anyone playing a stringed instrument that can't make it. So, my first full set was opening for you guys in Atlantic City.
Wow. That's awesome.
I played bass for them.
That's so wicked. It's
really cool. And then my first one on guitar, New Brunswick, New Jersey. But it was.
So tell me about the guitar. I know you and I had spoke about this briefly, if you remember, when we were by my guitars by the, backstage. You were looking at my guitars, and then you were like, I'm thinking about getting a guitar. Remember we talked about that at that show?
So it's not a Flying V. It's a Les Paul. Wait,
oh, do you want to nice.
Grab it? All right. It's on the stand in the basement. It's the one with like five guitars on it.
I love Les Pauls. That's been the guitar, the shape, the single cut shape I've played my whole life. Especially yep. Gibson or Epiphone, either one, you can't go wrong, or any others. I mean, it's just a great shape. It always usually has a very resonant sound.
Uh-huh.
That shape guitar.
But yeah, it's my first Les Paul. The rest, I got three Strats. One arch top, and then one Les Paul.
Nice, that's super cool.
Yeah. Okay, so.
Oh yeah.
So it was
covered,
I mean covered in stickers. So
wow.
I got Misfits one, the Blink in it. Whoopsies. I smacked.
Whoa.
Okay. I'm gonna
I
do
love
this way.
It.
And I kept the Blink 182 and Suicidal Tendency sticker.
Oh, that's a
and
killer
I
guitar.
Added,
I love it.
I added the Bad Religion Crossbuster because there were.
Is that a deep wine? That color? Is that a deep wine color?
I think.
Wow, I love it.
Yep. Thank you. But I got so we got this at Guitar Center for like $300 used,
cool.
But covered in stickers. And it's a Epiphone Les Paul Traditional 2.
That's awesome. Epiphone. I actually bring two Epiphone Les Pauls with me on the road. I don't know if you saw that when I was out. Did you see my Epiphone Les Pauls when we were out there?
I didn't.
White and black one? Yeah, I have two Epiphone Les Pauls with me out on the road all the time. Epiphone was so kind to send me a couple to check out, and I love them. They're Epiphone Les Paul Customs. And I swapped the pickup. I did a couple of things to them, but they are such great guitars. And it's so great that I continue to bring them out on the road with me and play them. And they
also,
sound great.
Yeah. Also, speaking of pickups, this thing has 100. They replaced the pickups on this. Whoever
I
has
see that
more,
Seymour Duncan
with $100 Seymour Duncan pickups.
Nice. That those.
So
pickups
that's $200 just in the two pickups. So then the rest was $100.
That's great.
And it's already put in.
And I'm sure it sounds great, right?
Yep, it sounds amazing. Like, this is. Keep smacking the arms of my chair. Yeah, they sold it a lot cheaper because the stickers. Okay, it's bad.
I love it. That's
yep.
A really badass guitar. I love it. I'm so impressed with all the Epiphone stuff and what they've been doing lately.
Yeah, they're amazing.
They're coming out with such amazing stuff, and they continue to. They have all kinds of stuff. I saw an Explorer recently that they came out with that looks so awesome. I was like, wow. And that's a shape I never had. I never had an Explorer, but just seeing that guitar made me want an Explorer. I was like, whoa.
I want an Explorer so bad. First, I kind of need a job.
Good. That's a good attitude. You know,
yep.
you know what things are worth. You know what it takes to you know, get things in life. And that's important. That's something not a lot of younger people know, like, or you know, how would you say, not a lot of younger people think about, like, hey, things cost money. You got to get out there and work if you want stuff. When I was a kid, I did the same thing. You know, I worked and I got guitars and amps, and that's how I built up my stuff and just kept working. I used to make raviolis in a pasta store. That's what I did.
That's awesome.
When I was a young kid, I was 12. And 13, I started working in pasta stores. I made raviolis, cavatelli. I don't know if you know what those are.
Ricotta.
Yeah, all that stuff I would make, you know, with the machines and stuff and the dough and the ricotta cheese and mozzarella. But yeah, that's what I did when I was a young kid to make money.
Also, back to the Les Paul. I paid $235 for it because my mom, that's all I had. And my mom paid like $65 difference because I didn't have enough.
That's so cool. That's what my mom did for me. It's same stuff, you know.
Wait, I think I had $230 actually.
That's cool.
I don't know.
You know, I think it's cool that you both kicked in for it. I did that with my mom when I was younger.
Yep.
Anything I wanted, she said, okay, if you work hard enough and you save up some money, I'll put in the rest. And that's exactly
Yep.
what we would do.
Also, it came with a hard case. I mean, it didn't come with it for free, but they had one lying around, and they said, "We'll give this to you if you pay for the $60 protection plan."
Okay. So you almost paid $60 for a case, basically. And so,
Yeah. So like,
and you got the protection plan on top of it.
yep.
So.
So $360 for a Les Paul with two Seymour Duncan pickups, a hard case with like a strap and stuff.
And a protection plan.
Yeah.
That you
That's
scored.
just crazy.
Yeah, that's you got an amazing deal. Let's
Yeah,
just
so
put it
like
that way.
yeah, three something with the case.
That's awesome. When's your next show?
So I might be playing next Tuesday, so like almost a week from now. A week
Cool.
and Monday. Because no one can't make it, or at least that I know of. But it's in Asbury Park, New Jersey. But if we're
What
able
is the
to,
place? What's the place called?
Salty's Bar.
Oh. It's called Salty's.
Yeah.
Is it called Salty's Beach Bar?
I think.
Oh,
And this is Asbury Park.
yeah. I think I don't know if I could talk about this yet, but I think we just got an offer to play there. It's funny.
Oh.
In the new year, at some point, I believe. I thought I
You want
just saw
us?
that.
Do you
So
want
yeah,
us?
that might be a place we might pop in and play. You
That's
know, that'd
so.
be fun.
Now, whoever's watching this has top secret information.
Yeah. Yep. You know, it's something that might be happening, I believe. So we'll see. It's funny you brought up that place. I just saw something about that with Life of Agony as a possibility.
Yep.
So that's some top secret stuff.
Yep. And if you need an opener, let us know, because Thought Control definitely will.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah, although the band doesn't do that stuff on our own, we all that's left up to the agents now and the club promoters. We kind of removed ourselves from that some years ago from because we always say, oh my, I want my friends to play. Oh, I want my friends to play. Everyone was always like that. So we realized that it would be a lot easier not being involved in that part of the decision making and
Makes
letting our
sense.
agent, yeah, letting our agent and the promoters take care of that stuff. So
Yep.
but you have an inside tip, so there's a good chance you can get on it.
Yeah,
And
hopefully.
you'll be playing there, so you could always mention to the guy, hey, I heard that Life of Agony might be playing here. Maybe we can
Yep.
get on it. Maybe we could do something like that.
Yep. Also, I know that album River Runs Red just celebrated its 30-year anniversary.
Yeah.
When did Life of Agony become a band?
We became a band in August of 1989. It was the summer of 1989. And we're just friends and well, obviously my cousin, but we had some friends. We would all hang out, listen to metal music, rock music, and we had a friend down the block. His name was Kenny P well, his name is Kenny P Peterson, and he had a drum kit in his garage. So I convinced my cousin Mina, who was Keith at the time, to come down the block with me because I wanted to jam with Kenny.
Yep.
And that's pretty much how the band started. Keith said yes, come down the block with you, grab the microphone, started singing off an insect can because we didn't have any lyrics, and I just had some riffs, and we jammed like that in the garage, just the three of us, Kenny, myself, and Keith at the time, and we just jammed like that and just made up stuff, and that was the first day, quote unquote, we started as a band. The band was called Capital Punishment at first. Then
Yep.
Alan joined the band, Alan Robert, who's a friend of ours. He was jamming across the street with a different friend. And
Yep.
then he ended up joining our band. And then we changed the name. Alan had an idea. He wanted to call Life of Agony. He had a dream.
That's
And
funny.
from there, it was history, you know?
Yeah, that's
And
awesome.
that, yeah. So Kenny Peterson was our first drummer.
Yep. So, how old were you?
We were just coming out of high school and all that. Yeah, so guess I was around 17 or 18 years old. Yeah, 17, 18, something like that.
Yeah. All yeah. Speaking of Alan Robert, and it was somewhere in New Jersey. I don't remember where, but there was like a punk rock thing, and
oh, that's so cool.
He was drawing people, so he drew me.
Oh, that's so wicked! What a good job.
He zombified people, and I got zombified. It was awesome.
That's so cool. He did it. Wow, Alan is so talented. He's such a talented person. He's spot on all the time.
What tour?
He just nails everyone.
What tour were we on? I don't remember.
I can't remember either.
Wait, was it Piebald's?
It was more recent than that. I'll think of it.
He has the ability to capture everyone's personality in the drawings. You could just like, he captures their total character, you know. He's really amazing.
Yep.
Matter of fact, I have a call with Alan at 12 o'clock. So we've got to keep an eye on the time too.
I remember where we were, sorry. So we went to, we were in New York for DRI grill, and Gorilla Biscuits.
Oh, DRI, I love that band. I grew up listening to them. I love the album was called Crossover. There was some songs on it. One was called Oblivion. I think another song was called Red Line. Great band. I love DRI.
I've seen them a bunch of times.
Say again?
I've seen them a bunch of times. They're really cool.
Oh, you did?
Yep.
Oh, wait. When was the first time you saw DRI?
So this is like a while ago, but Baltimore, Maryland. So I was 10 then. So I guess it had to be last year.
Wow.
My friend Jack came there too. So, Spike gave us the mic for Abduction, where the kids like sing.
Oh, that's so cool.
It's really fun.
You got to sing a bit with them too.
Yep.
Oh, that's so freaking cool. I love it.
Yep. And then we went on tour with them earlier this year. We didn't go on.
We followed them for 4 days. We
followed them for 4 days. but they went on. They were on like a, I think like 3 week tour in the Midwest.
Yeah.
But we followed for the days. It was St. Louis, Evansville, Indiana, Louisville, Kentucky, and then where was it? I can't remember. It was outskirts of Cincinnati, but it was in Kentucky.
Covington.
Okay.
Wow.
And Kurt let me sing with him. Kurt let me sing. It was a different song. It's Syringes in the Sandbox with him every night except for Evansville in Indiana.
Oh, wow. That's so awesome. I never got a chance. I haven't seen DRI live as much as I listened to them growing up and stuff like that. I've never seen them live. Matter of fact, it came up like we suggested that we, to our agent, that they should be a band that I think would work well with Life of Agony. Like if we toured together, I think our styles would definitely complement each other. I think we'd have some great shows. So we brought that band up as an option. So
We have their contact if you need it.
Oh, really? Yeah. I might actually, that's something I might hit you up for, because I'll just pass it on to my agent. Like we said, we're always looking to partner up with some cool bands to get out there and play. Obviously, like Sick of It All.
They tour. They're probably the band that tours like the most.
Wow. Yeah, I heard they do a lot of stuff. So I would love to get out there with them. It would be great to play with them on the West Coast.
And they're also in their like 60s. So. Kurt, Kurt was 61 and I'm 11.
60 years apart. So, 50. What am I saying?
Yep.
They're 50 years apart.
And their set is 90 minutes.
Wow. So he's really getting up there and doing it.
They play really long. Wow. But they also play the tiniest, like really hot clubs. Like they'll play 50 people clubs.
Okay, well, that's still cool.
It's awesome.
They're going to have, some intense shows, very intimate. I love shows like that sometimes. I really
do. They're really fun. It's just kind of funny. They play these tiny places, and they're pretty, big.
CBGB's, you know, sticks out as one of those clubs growing up. You know, it's such a popular club, but
CBGB's. I wish I was able to go.
Yeah, it was a small little space where people would stand to watch the bands. I mean, comfortably, you can only really fit like 80 to 100 people. You know, you put 100 people in front of that stage at CB's and it felt packed. So like,
yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it was one of those cool clubs that it was just a vibe, constant vibe in the air there. Very, very cool.
And now I went inside of it when I was in New York, probably a few months ago. And it's a clothing store now. Like, come on.
I know. I heard all about it. I heard they moved some of the walls to Las Vegas or something like that. Huh. Or somewhere, just the walls with all the graffiti, you know, with all the stickers and graffiti. And I heard they built it in some kind of, I don't know, I've never seen it before.
You think it was for the punk rock museum, maybe?
Maybe. That could be it. I don't know where they went, but I heard they moved the walls out west to Las Vegas for something. So I thought that was interesting that they at least preserved the walls. It would have been nice if the club was preserved and it was still here, but
yeah,
you know, at least they honored CB's by, you know, putting on display somewhere.
Yeah. Which is pretty cool. Did you guys ever get to play there?
Oh yeah, many times. Life of Agony, awesome. I think we played there at least two or three times in our career, at different stages of our career, and always amazing shows there. Always. Wow. I remember one show we did, the last one we did, I think it was 2005, and it looked like two layers of people. It looked like the first layer of people, and it looked like people on top of people. It was so crazy. Like, it was just a madhouse. Awesome. And yeah, that was a great show. You all right? Need water?
Nah. So do you have a favorite Life of Agony song to play?
Wow. Oh, I love, I mean, there's so many, but I love playing Underground. One of my favorites to play.
Yeah.
I love playing River Runs Red, the song River Runs Red.
Yep. My parents love to mosh to Underground every time they see it.
Yeah, I think I've seen your mom in the pit more than once at a Life of Agony show. Where are you, Brooke?
Can't help myself.
I think I've seen you like arm swinging and windmilling people. I don't know what you're doing in there, but I've seen you in there.
Embarrassing.
No, it's cool. I think it's pretty cool.
So what was the first punk, hardcore, metal show you attended, and how old were you?
Wow. Believe it or not, I was pretty young. I'm trying to think back which one was earlier. I think Sheer Terror at Lemoore's, I want to say, if you want to consider that hardcore, which I would.
Definitely.
Yeah, so I think it was Sheer Terror at Lemoore's. Also, Biohazard. I was very young. Go to Lemoore's, see Biohazard. Carnivore, which was Pete Steele's band from Type O, his earlier band. And then they turned into a band called Retaliation. Like bands like that were my earliest. I did see the Cro-Mags, and I believe that was at Lemoore's as well. That was like our club we would go to the most because we lived in Brooklyn. That's okay, you can call.
Yep.
Are you there? I would say, you know, I'm trying to think back. It's hard to nail the very first one, but I believe it was Sheer Terror was the very first hardcore show we went to as kids. I think that was the band we saw. And then there was bands like Leeway, which was friggin' awesome. And like I said, Cro-Mags, Agnostic Front. I remember we played with Agnostic Front, Life of Agony, at the Sundance with a band called Nausea and Rest in Pieces. That was a great show. Rest in Pieces. It was Life of Agony, Rest in Pieces, Nausea, and Agnostic Front. It was like, what a great show. That was that club called the Sundance in Long Island.
Yeah, it was awesome.
It was a hardcore show.
Yep. So what are some of your favorite bands to see live?
Favorite bands to see live? Like I had mentioned earlier, Gojira, they're for sure. They're like one of those bands that, I mean, they're just amazing. I love seeing, believe it or not, as a a bunch of bands I love seeing live, even in different genres. I love seeing Stained. I don't know if you ever seen Stained live.
I don't think I know them.
Yeah, they're just a great band and a great singer, Aaron. I love seeing Metallica, of course, live. I mean, can't beat a Metallica concert. You know, those guys get up there for 2 hours and 15 minutes or whatever it is and wow. hammer it out and just, so, I mean,
135 minutes.
That's their set, yeah.
That beats DRI.
That's like DRI?
No, I said that beats DRI.
Oh, beats DRI, about, yeah.
45 minutes.
Yeah, yeah. They Metallica hammers it out for a while up there. And it's always a great show, always an amazing show. Who else? I've seen so many bands that Deftones. I love seeing the Deftones live.
Yeah, my dad likes them some.
I like seeing Korn too. I love seeing Korn live.
You guys,
Korn's a great band.
Haven't you guys like played with them before?
Something? Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, many times. All of these bands. We even had the opportunity to be on the same bill with Metallica at a show in England many years ago.
Oh wow. You guys take it?
Download Festival, huh?
You guys, did you take it or what?
Oh, yeah. We played, yep.
Right, yeah, that's awesome.
We had the opportunity to play. Oh, well, I don't want to say it was opening for Metallica because it was a festival.
Well, yeah, it was a festival.
They were the headliner, so I guess, yeah, you're opening for Metallica that day. And yeah, technically, and it was a great, great day. What a great show that was. Yep. You know, it's cool because once you get out there, you know, we played with Iron Maiden, Ozzy Osbourne, Judas Priest, all these big bands that I grew up listening to. You know, we ended up playing with Kiss. We played with Kiss. But a lot of these are festivals.
Yeah,
what I'm saying is lot of these opportunities we got were because we were on European festivals. It wasn't like we were just on tour with Iron Maiden or on tour with... Oh, yeah. Although we did tour with Ozzy. It was Life of Agony, Korn, and Ozzy Osbourne.
Yeah, it's still amazing, like, getting to do all those crazy festivals.
Yeah, and one of the coolest ones we did was in Milton Keynes, England, and it was when Black Sabbath got back together.
Oh, wow.
We played that show, the very first show they got back together.
Was it a festival or a show?
It was considered a festival, but it was really a Black Sabbath reunion show. And we got to do that, and we went on in between Pantera and Slayer. So Pantera went on because the stages were side by side. So Pantera went on this stage, then Life of Agony, then Slayer, then Megadeth, and then Black Sabbath. So it was we were sandwiched between Pantera and Slayer, but Pantera.
You played at the same time as Pantera.
No, not at the same time. We you know, one stage goes and then the next. So we had to go on after Pantera.
That's crazy.
Which was ridiculous. Like, those guys, I mean, this is when, you know, God bless them, Dime was alive and Vinny was alive, and he was back in 1998. Going on after Pantera, that was super difficult. That's all I got to say. You know, hitting the stage after Dimebag just fucking, excuse my language, after Dimebag just tore up.
Is that the first F-bomb? No, yours was the first F-bomb. Well, yeah, first F-bomb that was.
No, there's been more.
Yeah, trying to, you know, well, we did okay. You know, we got up there and we did our thing, Life of Agony. But let me tell you something. I remember the feeling I had watching Pantera from our stage, and we're about to go on after them. And I remember going, oh my God, this is insane. And then Slayer went on after us. So it was just, wow, what a day. But it was a fun day. It was amazing. And then we watched Black Sabbath, and that was incredible.
Yeah,
on the side of the stage.
Like, are they still together or no?
I'm sure, you know, well, you know, they have done things here and there. I don't know as of lately, you know, I don't know lately if they're planning on doing anything but you know, I think the last time they did something was a bunch of years ago. They did an album. They did like a record or something a few years ago. I think it was right before COVID, maybe, I'm going to say, like maybe three or 4 years ago, came out with a new record, Black Sabbath. And I was hearing songs on the radio and stuff like that. But got to give them credit for still, give Ozzy credit for still putting himself out there.
Isn't he like 80 or something?
I have no idea. I don't know his actual age, but
I think he's 70 something actually.
Yeah, he must be 70 something or even low 70s. I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. He probably kicked both of our asses if he knew we were talking about his age.
The only song I know is Iron Man.
Uh-huh.
I don't know them very well, but I just know. It's covered.
Gotta get some water, yeah. You.
So he's 74. But
oh,
yeah,
74.
I can't.
Okay, get some water.
Okay.
Get some water.
Yep. I sound like I'm 50 years old and like.
That's what happens when you start talking about the Prince of Darkness, which is Ozzy Osbourne.
He's cursing
that
me.
That tends to happen to people. I don't know why they start choking.
Cursing me for sure.
I gotta jump on a call in about 11 minutes, so
yep.
Might have to
five more minutes.
Yeah, any more questions? Yeah,
two more questions.
Okay.
Get to them.
Yep.
cut that
oh,
out.
Man.
Okay,
that was cool.
So, if you could tell your 11-year-old self anything at all, what would you tell him?
Wow. I'd probably tell my 11-year-old, that's a great question. I tell my 11-year-old self that stop worrying, everything's going to be okay.
Nice.
Yeah. Because as you live life, you realize that you spend a lot of time worrying about things that never end up happening.
Yeah.
And everything's going to be okay. So remember that. I said that to you. Don't worry about anything. Everything's going to work out. Everything's going to be all right.
Well, nice message. So anything to add before we wrap it up?
Yeah, I first of all would like to thank you and apologize that it took so long to get this together. It was super fun. But I'm glad we ended up, doing it now. It's perfect time for me. It was a heck of a busy year and I'm grateful. This is part of what I like to add to this last bit.
Yep.
I'm really grateful for everything that's been happening and everything that's going on with Life of Agony and in my life personally. I'm a humble type person and I appreciate things and I'm, I've always been that way and I plan to stay that way. And that's something always good for you to remember, like stay humble, be yourself, no matter what I do, I'm still just Joseph Zampella. That's just the person I was born as. So I could be working at a job down the street at a mail store, or I could be on stages rocking in front of, 80,000 people.
Yeah, and you're
but
still
I'm
the same
still
person.
I'm still just me. Doesn't matter. Yep. And I always try to remember that. So I'm just grateful for everything. I'm grateful for the 30th anniversary. Having a blast out there on tour.
Yep. And that's awesome you guys still together. Like most hardcore bands only last a few years, right? That's usually
it's we're very blessed. I always say it. I say it on stage. We're very blessed. We're very lucky.
Yeah.
All the fans that and friends that still keep coming out to the shows and they're right there in front of us and singing the words with us, having a great time.
Yep.
It's nothing like it. And we're super appreciative of it. And I just want to thank you also. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah.
And it was a lot of fun. And you got to let me know when it's about to come out. If they'll come out today, or let me know.
Yeah. And thanks to Joey for joining me today. And thanks to all of you for watching or listening. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel and follow me on Spotify and other streaming platforms. Until next week, bye.
Bye.